Hello everyone, my name is Daryl and I have Vincent joining me in this video to provide a demonstration on VSX Logical VTAP Live Upgrade. The objective of this demo is to share with you the performance of AOSCX software upgrade in terms of resiliency while upgrading a pair of VSX TOR switches from one major release to another major release. You see both Layer 2 Layer 3 network connectivity across the data center networking fabric using EVPN and Layer 3 distributed gateways. This is the agenda for this video, and for anyone who would like to fast forward, we have provided timings to enable you to skip to the desired section stated on this slide. So Vincent, could you please explain the demonstration and topology?
Sure. Here is the topology used to demonstrate the Aruba software upgrade performance of the VSX VTAP switches. We use two spine switches and two logical leaf VTAPs. Each logical leaf is a VSX cluster of a pair of Aruba top-of-rack switches like 8325 or 8360. VSX VTAP 1 represents a unique logical VTAP built with two physical switches, leaf 1A and leaf 1B. Same for VSX VTAP 2. Let me remind everyone very shortly on the VSX technology. The virtual switching extension provides layer 2 multi-chassis link aggregation as a virtualization technique in order to simplify the networked data plane by removing the need of spanning tree. One of the very important architecture principles of VSX is that both VSX nodes of the VSX cluster run an independent control plane, each with their own router ID. It provides as well many operational benefits like configuration synchronization, show commands from a single node, and live upgrade orchestration that we will see in the demonstration. In this typology, VSX link aggregation are used to provide active-active layer 2 connectivity to the server. The Blade server interconnection modules or standalone servers will run standard LACP. In gray are represented pure layer 2 downlinks to the server. In green are represented routed point-to-point circuits between spines and leaves. We made abstraction to any external connectivity to the core network or WAN routers for the purpose of simplifying the demo.
Great. So how is the distributed control plane set up?
So the EVPN VXLAN control plane relies on multi-protocol BGP and its L2VPN EVPN address family. So let's consider in this demonstration a single autonomous number, here AS65001. This is the internal BGP model where the spines are the IBGP route reflector and leaves are IBGP route reflector clients. IBGP peerings are established between loopback interfaces. And we have OSPF running as the interior gateway protocol to establish reachability between loopback IP addresses, including the VTAP Anycast loopback 1 address, sourcing the VXLAN tunnels. Here, the VLAN 2 is transported over the VSX inter-switch link, is used for path resiliency to reach over fabric node loopbacks, even if both uplinks of the switch fail.
So here, each spine has two internal BGP sessions to each logical VTAP over these point-to-point layer 3 circuits with a total of 4 sessions per spine?
Exactly. Each logical VTAP consists in two VSX nodes, each running its own control plane for both BGP and OSPF.
So it means that when we upgrade the VSX cluster, there will always be one node up and running while the VSX peer is rebooting. Is that correct?
Yes, correct. This is this fundamental architecture principle of VSX that provides the always-on capability of VSX VTAP during an upgrade. In addition, we show here NetEdit server that can be used to operate any configuration change on each switch.
Good. Can you go back to the wording of VSX Logical VTAP and explain how VTAP or VXLAN tunnel endpoint works in conjunction with VSX?
Yes, the VSX, the Leaf VSX cluster acts as a logical VTEP because the VXLAN tunnel is sourced from a single virtual IP address, which is here the loopback 1 interface. So this is 11.3 here. Loopback 0 interfaces are used to establish IBGP sessions, whereas EVPN routes are sourced with the loopback 1 Anycast IP address as the next stop of those routes. This IP address is shared between the VSX primary and the VSX secondary of the same VSX cluster. So here in the orange link represents the VXLAN tunnels between the Anycast IP of VTEP 1, this is .3, and the Anycast IP of VTEP 2, which is .5.
Understood. This is the virtual representation. But in reality, each VSX node of VTEP 1 will construct a VXLAN tunnel to each remote VSX node of VTEP 2.
Absolutely. These VXLAN tunnels will be automatically established thanks to the EVPN control plane.
Understood again. So please explain the tenant and what L2 VNI and L3 VNI mean.
In this demo, we have two VRFs, virtual routing forwarding table. We have VRF1 for tenant 1 and VRF2 for tenant 2. Inside each tenant, one L2 VNI is assigned per VLAN. So here, 10.0.0.10 is assigned for VLAN 10, for instance, for layer 2 VLAN extension between racks. And a single layer 3 VNI is assigned and used to route traffic inside a VRF between different subnets. So like between layer 3 SVI, 10, 11, and 12.
If I understand correctly, the server on the left in VLAN 10 will be able to communicate with the server on the right over the same VLAN 10. VLAN 10 is extended with the L2 VNI. In addition, this server in VLAN 10 on the left will be able to reach the server on the right in VLAN 12 thanks to the L3 VNI distributed routing.
Exactly correct. And tenant 1, of course, cannot communicate to tenant 2 as expected thanks to different VRF. If requested, this inter-VRF communication would be possible through inter-VRF route leaking that may be configured either on a border leaf VTEP, that would be exactly VTEP 1, for instance, or on an external firewall. So here is the logical representation of VLAN extension for pure layer 2 traffic. This is the L2 VNI. And the representation of routing with L3 VNI for inter-VLAN routing. So in the example, here we've got in rack 1, that workload 10.1.10.10 will communicate with 10.1.10.11 in rack 2, thanks to the L2 VNI 10.0.0.10 extending VLAN 10. And in these slides, the same server, the same workload, 10.1.10.10 here in rack 1 will communicate with 10.1.12.10 in rack 2 thanks to the layer 3 VNI routing inside VRF1. Indeed, we do not have VLAN 12 hosted behind VSX VTEP 1. It's only behind VSX VTEP 2. So we have to use layer 3 VNI to reach that workload.
Good. So can you please go back to the physical setup and explain the switch model being used?
Here we use 8325 as leaf switches. 8360 could be used as well. This setup is for demo only. So 6300 as spine is only for that lab and demo purpose and not for production, as this is not scope for data center networking. Traditionally, servers would be directly connected to the 8325 top of rack. Here, we use some intermediate switches due to server connectivity optimization. Here's the very detailed slides, I would say, to recap all the physical links to help reading the switch configuration. These slides and the configuration of all the switches is available on Erez. You have the view of that in this slide.
Great. Now that we understand the setup, let's go through some live verification. Let's use NetEdit, test connectivity, check the underlay OSPF, BGP, VXLAN tunnels, MAC and EVPN as well.
So on NetEdit, so if I click next on this tunnel here, you see that on the right side, I have the associated VTAP information. And with the VTAP source address, the VTAP destination address, if this is operational, and what is the VLAN being extended.
Great. This seems very handy indeed. Can we also get into the CLI to check the setup?
Yeah, sure. So let's go in the CLI and see what happened in the CLI. So first of all, let's get to the spine and have the visibility of the connectivity. Okay, so here, I do a show LLDP neighbor. So you see that here you've got the four physical switches. So the first two is the VTAP one, logical VTAP one, and the last two are the logical VTAP two. Then we can take a look at maybe OSPF, the underlay routing. So again, on the spine, I can check my neighbors. So here you've got all those leaf switches that are actually active. And something that remember, loopback one is the Anycast IP used to source or terminate a VXLAN tunnel. So it would be interesting to see how that spine is actually having reachability for that Anycast loopback. So this one is 68.11.3. And you can see that from the spine, I've got two equal cost paths to reach that Anycast IP loopback for the logical VTAP 1 through the leaf 1A and through leaf 1B, equal cost. We can also take a look at the BGP. So show BGP all VRF summary. And we have all the BGP sessions established to the leaves. Okay, so you can really see that all the nodes inside VSX cluster have their own control plane. Yeah, it's really the same than OSPF, as I mentioned before. We can also check, for instance, on leaf 1A, for instance, the show BGP sessions that we have on spine one and spine two. Here on the topology, we have two spines.
Great, that was the control plane, right? Can you show us the data plane, Nick?
Yeah, so the interesting aspect of the data plane is for the interface that we have with VXLAN. So this is show interface VXLAN, and we have only one interface for that one. So you see that it's very handy and good summary of extended VLANs, all the information that we have in one command, the VLAN that are extended, the associated L2 VNI for that VLAN. If we need routing, it's enabled on which L3 VNI do we have routing for which VRF. We have remote VTAP IP information. And on top of that, we have some statistics for encapsulated and decapsulated packets. So the more or less the volume of traffic that we have. Also, we can see obviously the regular VLAN information. And per VLAN, you will see that that interface VXLAN is member of that VLAN.
Great. So what about the show MAC address? Is that useful as well?
Of course, we can take a look at the show MAC address table to check the information that provides the MAC address learned by the traditional data plane. This is the dynamic aspect for the keyword. And we have the MAC learned from the EVPN control plane that appeared with the keyword VPN, and you see the port that is the VXLAN one with the remote IP for the VTEP. So similarly, we have as well a very useful command. This is show EVPN MAC IP that provides you the control plane information for the EVPN route type 2, where you see the flag that is L like local. And pretty much here, I've got that IP, which is remote. This is on the over rack, and this is appearing with a flag R, like remote, with the IP address of the remote VTEP. So very handy capability.
Okay. What about the IP routing table?
Yes, so the IP routing table inside, for instance, the tenant VRF. So here, IP show IP route VRF VRF1. That is, you see a lot of /32 entries. Okay, so those 32 entries are required to perform routed traffic to the destination virtual machine that can be moved or resides behind any VTEP or any racks. If we do a vMotion, it can appear behind any racks where we've got the same VLAN being extended. So this is very useful to have that traffic being routed to that /32.
Perfect. I think we are ready to go with the live upgrade.
So yes, exactly. So I'm going to explain you exactly what we are going to do during that that live upgrade. Not in terms of test flows. So the parameters that are used, the flows that are used, and so on. So the test parameters: the initial OSCX version running on the VSX VTEP on the left is 10.05.40. This is the initial version. So we'll be upgrading to 10.06.10. So it's an upgrade between two major releases. One point to keep in mind, the OSPF metric that we have on startup, so as soon as the device is rebooting, it will not participating immediately to the VXLAN data plane. So we'll have to have that timer, which is set here to between 100 to 300 seconds, to have the time for the BGP routes to be installed, to have all the EVPN routes information ready to participate to the VXLAN data plane. So we have that timer to delay a bit the rebooted device to participate to the data plane. To demonstrate the high availability of the solution during the upgrade, we want to stress quite a lot the EVPN VXLAN fabric with layer 2 traffic and layer 3 traffic. So let's use here a simple ICMP flow, interactive flow, to show traffic, how traffic is getting and crossing the fabric. So I'm going to show you that in a while.
Understood. But can we use more than these simple ICMP flows? Is that possible?
Yes, so absolutely. We want to stress a lot the platform. So there are three types of traffic items that are set up with Ixia. A pure layer 2 traffic inside a VLAN, which is VLAN 10. That would be a one-to-one traffic flow between 100 endpoints, so 50 endpoints on the left. So here you've got the Ixia port here. So we have 50 endpoints behind that Ixia port on the left, 50 behind here. So it's a total of 100 endpoints, 50 bidirectional flows with a total traffic throughput assigned for that traffic item of 3 gigabit per second. Then we have a pure layer 2 traffic, exactly the same, but on VLAN 20, where we increase a little bit the endpoint. So we double the endpoint. So it would be a total of 100 endpoints on the left, 100 on the right. So that's 200 flows due to the fact they are bidi. And this is a traffic volume of 3.5 gigabit per second. And finally, we have routed traffic using layer 3 VNI and distributed gateway between VLAN 10 and VLAN 12. This is a full mesh traffic between 50 endpoints per subnet on the left to the 50 other endpoint on the right side. So we'll have 50 times 50, 2,500 flows, okay? And these are bidi, so it's 5,000 flows with a total of 3 gigabit per second for that. So overall, we've got 100 endpoints, 5,300 flows. It's a UDP traffic that I simulate. Packet size is 300 bytes, and we've got almost the 10 gig port that is used on that switch below. It's 9.5 gigabit per second being used. In addition, we monitor the number of packets per second on each circuit, so the leaf spine circuits, as well as the downlinks going to the server.
So before upgrading, can you show us the impact in case of link or device failures?
Yeah, excellent idea. This is an opportunity for us to actually prove that the platform that is used here is valid, and we can have a comparison reference against what happened if, for instance, I'm losing a spine versus the impact of an upgrade. So that's quite interesting to see that. So let's move forward with the shutting down, for instance, all the circuits of the spine to see really the impact on the platform. So let's start the traffic first. So I'm going to move on that window here. You see here, this is all the links that I'm monitoring. So on the left, this is all the links to spine one. And on the right side, these are all the links to spine two. Bottom are the downlinks to the server. So here, the two first here are for leaf one. So leaf 1A is the first row. Leaf 1B is the VS6 secondary. That's the second row, and so on. So that's for the monitoring of the traffic. It's packet per second. So anything appearing in blue would be the inbound traffic received by the leaf, and green would be anything outbound, packet per second. So let's move now to those interactive flows. Okay, so this is a workload, a virtual machine that is attached on the left. So this is 10, 1, 10, 10, and I'm going to ping .11. And you'll see live that the traffic is hitting that down. So that this is that circuit here from the server that we it and be active on that spine two here. So this is really the how the traffic is distributed by the fabric. I do not master that. It's hashing that is performed downstream and ECMP that is performed upstream. So let's start a second flow. Okay, you see that second flow is using pretty much the same links, except here we've got one more link that is being used here. So let's use here the third flow. Now I've got another link that is used here and other links here. So that's we are distributing the traffic. As more we have flows, more we will distribute the traffic over all the fabric circuits. And this is the last one. So these are my interactive flows. Okay. Anytime I've got a dot appearing here, I will have a packet that is dropped. So the timeout is set to 10 milliseconds and I'm sending traffic every 10 milliseconds. So to calculate the traffic impact, I will multiply the packet loss times 10 milliseconds to understand how much I lost. So let's move now with Ixia. And I'm going to start those traffic. So maybe the app will not be learned at the very start. So I may stop and start again Ixia. It depends whether we see a lot of packet loss duration at the very initial test. So here, yes, everything is running fine. So the ARP entries were already there. So that's why you see, even starting the traffic, I have no loss. So what I use here in Ixia, just to make sure that we understand clearly how the monitoring is being performed, the custom view that I'm checking here is about a view with the flow detective. So here on Ixia, I'm not just going to go quickly because maybe most of you do not know very well Ixia, but what I'm doing, I'm reporting the worst performers flow out of the 5,300 flows, the worst 100 flows that are performing with the regarding the criteria, which is the frame delta, the delta between the received frame and the transmit frame. Between Ixia. This is what I'm monitoring and I'm reporting here. So the very first one that I see here would be the worst. So here it's a nominal situation. The frame delta is either zero or one. Okay. So I will watch out carefully the packet loss duration of the first row. That would be the worst case during the impact. So let's move forward with shutting down on the spine the circuits. So I'm going to do a shutdown. So I can do a show LLDP neighbor and I'm going to shut down interface 25 to 28. And immediately see what happened on Ixia. You see here on Ixia, the worst duration is 757 milliseconds. So let's take a look on the graphs. You see that I had a million packets per second. Yeah, that's the scale is 1160. We have traffic loaded on all circuits, and then everything is shut down for all the circuits going to spine one, and this is spine two taking over all the traffic and traffic volume due to spine one not participating any longer to the fabric. So let's take a quick look on the interactive flow to see how much we lost on those flows. So here, that one was not impacted because not using that one neither. That one was impacted. So pretty much you see here that so this is the difference between the transmitted and the receiving packet. So here we have pretty much 80 packets. So that was 800 milliseconds. And here we have 68 packet missing, so this is 680 milliseconds. So less than 1 second of outage losing the spine. So this is quite good. This is expected due to the availability and rerouting through OSPF of the traffic up to the Anycast loopback one IP address. So I'm going to no shut those circuits, and obviously. Stop and start the traffic. So this is to recap. This is what we have for the spine.